you're watching To The Point. The fate of the 46 nurses has dominated the news today amidst reports that they could have been or are about to be freed. But the 39 construction workers in Mosul remain in ISIL captivity. We believe they are safe and unharmed, but they are also being held against their will and very possibly forced to work as their captors demand. So what's the precise status of the nurses at this point of time? How sure are we of their freedom? And then, secondly, can the Indian government do anything to help the construction workers? That's still a problem that remains to be attended to. Or is the government, at least in this respect, somewhat helpless? My guests are former ambassador to Iran, Casey Singh, the strategic affairs editor of The Hindu, who's just returned from Iraq, Praveen Swamy, and the executive director of the Institute for Conflict Management, Ajay Sani. Praveen Swamy, let me start with you. You have contacts in Kurdish government sources, you've got people who are speaking to you. Can we be reasonably sure after the end of the government's press conference that these nurses, even if they haven't reached Erbil, are safely on their way, that they are close to or have crossed the border and therefore are in what I would call free territory and outside captivity? Can we be reasonably sure that's happened or will be happening soon?
Syed Akbaruddin, the government spokesman who just spoke to the media a short while ago, was a little equivocal about whether the nurses had yet left, that is, ISIS held territory into Kurdistan, which is safe. All he would say was that they will reach Erbil tonight. Now, Erbil is give or take an hour and a half from the border, which is right on the outskirts of Mosul. So one would presumably conclude from that they probably are not in Kurdish territory yet. The Kurdish government also said at about 4 o'clock this afternoon that they hadn't crossed any of their border check posts yet. So a little bit of mystery about this, but the government indeed seeming extremely confident that they're safe. They've said that they will reach Erbil tonight and that they will be put on a plane directly to Kochi, and that there will be Indian officials standing by and waiting for them at the airport when they arrive. I assume the government's confidence is well-founded, but we'll just have to wait and see how events actually unfold.
Casey Singh, to recapitulate the position at this moment, and it's important we be accurate and we also be perfectly balanced, we aren't absolutely sure that the nurses have crossed the border into Kurdish territory. Kurdish officials speaking to Praveen Swamy have indicated that hasn't happened. On the other hand, the government is pretty confident that by nightfall this evening they will have reached Erbil, which is the capital of Kurdistan. Could there be any last-minute hitches and problems which, God forbid, disturb what we hope will be an unimpeded progress into free territory?
Karan, we don't know whom the government is speaking to. We don't know who the sources are. They have been brought from Tikrit and they've been driven up. We thought they had gone to another location where the abduction was going to continue. Now, having come to Mosul, considering the other workers are also in Mosul, now is it two different factions in Mosul, which are one faction holding the workers, another faction holding the nurses? That's why they are releasing, one of them is releasing the nurses. We don't know. We don't know what is the arrangement. It is possible that it's still daylight there. They are probably a couple of hours, 2.5 hours behind us. So they'll have another 2 hours extra of daylight beyond our time. Now, I don't know whether the Kurdish autonomous zone keeps their border open. If they don't come by a certain time, I'm sure the Indian embassy will be working it out with them. So because we don't know the dynamics of what is happening in Mosul, is it one group? Is it hierarchical? Okay. Is it more than one group? Therefore, who is the government? Whom are the government talking to? It's difficult to comment.
Ajay Sani, a lot depends on exactly at what time the nurses cross the border, and as Casey Singh said, whether they do it during daylight hours or whether that border shuts down after the sun sets. We don't have the answers to that, so let's not speculate about that. But what sort of complement of Indian staff are awaiting the nurses on the Kurdish end? And what sort of formalities will need to be completed, and how much time will that take so that once they reach Erbil, they can catch that special plane that's been sent for them? How complicated are those formalities and the procedures that need to be fulfilled?
Well, Well, I think most of that would have been taken care of because no bureaucratic processes are going to be followed over here. This is being handled at a fairly senior level, a very high level of government on both sides. And we are informed that representatives both of the central government and of the Kerala government will be accompanying the plane. I am not aware of any very significant current presence of Indian diplomats in the Kurdish areas. So I cannot with confidence say that there is an adequate available staff to deal with them. But clearly there have been some people who have been placed over there over the past few days. There is no permanent diplomatic council or presence in Erbil or in the Kurdish areas.
Now, Praveen Swamy, you were in Erbil. You have contacts with the Kurdish authorities. You have been in touch with them. Do you have any assurance that if there are last-minute hitches, and once again, God forbid there won't be, but if there are last-minute hitches, do we have an assurance that the Kurdish authorities will help and assist and facilitate our nurses, not leave them stranded at the border, unable to cross over?
The Kurdish authorities have been very, very helpful to the large number of countries who found their citizens in harm's way in recent months. I don't think there will be a problem there at all. Remember that the Kurds were the ones who facilitated the release of 39 truck drivers yesterday, Turkish truck drivers. In that case, of course, it's being speculated that a fairly large ransom was paid, that assurances of petrol supplies were being held out. We don't know. The one slightly odd thing in this, Karan, is that given that, you know, the transfer is not yet actually a done deal in the sense that the nurses are not yet in complete safety. What the reason was to make these announcements in advance of the event is I'm not clear. I understand the Kerala government were the ones who started speaking about this first. But I have to say I'm a little perplexed at this official garrulousness, which is quite uncharacteristic.
Let me put that particular point to you, KC Singh. In fact, what you heard Praveen Swamy refer to is a press conference done just a little while ago by the Chief Minister of Kerala, Uman Chandy, and he was claiming that within an hour the nurses would be in Erbil. At another point in time, he claimed that they had in fact crossed over and were in the custody of Indian officials. All that while, the MEA was completely silenced, and I can add that MEA sources were absolutely perplexed by what Mr. Uman Chandy was saying because they had none of the information that he was allegedly making public. So what explains the garrulousness, as Praveen Swamy called it, of the Kerala Chief Minister and the reticence of the MEA and the fact that the MEA is still indicating they're not sure if the nurses have crossed the border, although they are confident that by nightfall they will have got to Erbil? What explains the different line taken by the Kerala Chief Minister and the MEA?
Look, you, having been ambassador to UAE, you must understand for Kerala, the population in the Gulf is kind of an extension of, not just a diaspora, it's literally an extension of their population, and they have tremendous contacts in all these places. All kinds of businessmen with all kinds of links with local governments. And secondly, the families have been getting, both in Punjab as well as in Kerala, because of telecommunications, they've been getting messages much quicker than the MEA. But the impression I got from the Chief Minister's press conference was that he obviously, he may be using his own sources. We don't know, because these sources are quite useful, because they are linked into all the commercial and the political network in the Gulf, and some of them extremely influential. So I would not be at all surprised if the Kerala government has a parallel network running through which they are getting their own feedback. And then they are supplementing it. And I think that's part of the reason that you find, you know, this dissonance sometimes between MEA and the government in Kerala.
You use the word dissonance, and you're also suggesting that the Kerala government has sources that clearly the MEA doesn't have access to, or at least those sources are not being shared with the MEA. Is this dissonance a little disturbing? I know that today is becoming a good news day, and I want very much to move on to the good news aspect of the nurses being freed. But first, this question, is this dissonance between two authorities, the MEA and the Kerala Chief Minister, a little disconcerting?
You're asking me?
I am indeed. Yes, KC Singh.
Well, this, I think partly we must remember, one is a Congress-led government and the other one is a BJP-led government. Some, you know, competition would be there on that account. But I would imagine really it needs to be, because as Praveen said, it's such a sensitive issue when we don't know what are the sources they are using. Probably sometimes preliminary release of information, raising of expectations may not in some way jeopardize the operation. So therefore, it is not good.
Okay.
They should have been on the same page completely.
Let's come, Ajay Sahni, to the presumed outcome, which is that by the end of this evening, the nurses will have reached Erbil, which is free territory. They will then be able to get onto that special plane being sent by the Indian government and back in Kochi by 7 a.m. tomorrow, Saturday. I'm going on the assumption that there will be no hitches and this is going to be the outcome. That being the case, how much of a success is this? How much of a feather in the cap is this for the MEA, number one, for Sushma Swaraj, the minister, number two, and the Modi government, number three?
You see, I think even if we go back to the whole issue you were speaking of in terms of the dissonance between the Kerala government and the centre, and this issue of who is going to take credit for it all, I have no evidence whatsoever to suggest that any of these, either the Kerala government or the government in Delhi, had actually established direct contact with the captors till yesterday, certainly. And there is no reason to believe that they have done so today, because again, you see, all these messages that are coming directly from the families. They are coming back, they are coming from the captives, either to their families or to media sources. This seems to be the principal source of information. I am getting to that. Consequently, I think neither government is really in charge of this operation. What we are seeing is what appears to be a Suomoto decision on the part of the captors to release these people, not under any direct negotiation or pressure from the Indian government.
That's
consequently, I think we would be, unless we get far more detail about what has happened, jumping the gun to give anybody any credit on this.
Well, that's a very interesting analysis. Let me ask Praveen Swamy whether he shares any of it. What you've effectively heard Dr. Sahni say is that no government, neither the Kerala government nor the central government, deserves any real credit for the successful release and hopefully return to India of the nurses tomorrow morning. Would you agree with it? And secondly, before you answer...
Yes, actually...
Can I just add, is there any reason that you may have for believing that in fact we did a deal? The Turkish government, when they secured the release of their 32 truck drivers, had actually done a deal. They had agreed to make some $10 million worth of petrol available to ISIL, which is desperately short of petrol. Could anything similar have happened, which is not officially acknowledged by the Indian side? Answer the two questions together, please.
The first part, I completely agree with Dr. Sahni. I don't think anyone on the Indian side should get very much credit for this. I think, in fact, that the key factor has been that and not necessarily ISIS, but many of the people working with ISIS, the former Ba'ath party officials, the tribal leaders on the Sunni end of the fence, have been eager to project that they are responsible figures, because running short of fuel, running short of food, they desperately need to persuade neighboring states and the international community that they're not lawless criminals and that they can be trusted. And I think these releases are part of that decision they have taken, not anything we have done. On the question of ransoms, again, I very much doubt if India paid anything, because I see no evidence that anyone other than the Iraqi Red Cross had any channels to these people. Unlike the Turks, we don't have an intelligence service that has long-standing links with these groups. And I think the decision is theirs. We will have to wait and see now what happens to the Indians still in Mosul, about whom we have no news. And as we celebrate the, you know, this heartening news, we should also spare a thought for the 39 Indians still trapped there and their increasingly desperate families.
I'll come to you about that, because you're an authority on the condition of those 39 construction workers. You were the one who reported, and so far as I can tell, no one else has, that in fact they have been forced and press ganged into forced manual labor to build earthworks and defensive fortifications in Mosul. I'll come to that in a moment's time. But very quickly, Casey Singh, both Dr. Sahni and Praveen Swamy are reluctant to give credit to any government for the successful release and hopefully return home tomorrow of the nurses. They believe that no one deserves credit. Do you agree with that, or do you think they are being a little churlish?
I think let's say the jury is out on that, because we don't know the details of this. Just to pick up on what has been said earlier, if ISIS or the captors are being charitable, then why this differential treatment? Why let the nurses go, who were brought all the way from Tikrit, and these other workers are in Mosul? Why were they not together? Why were they not released together? We don't know the motives. Why they're doing it? Is it simply because they're women, they're being let off?
Can I interrupt? Are you therefore suggesting that there may have been some sort of deal or understanding? I hesitate to use the dirty word bargain, just as the Turks had a deal or understanding to secure the release of their 32 truck drivers. Do you think something like that would have happened with the nurses and hasn't happened with the construction workers, which is why the construction workers remain in captivity? Are you hinting or suggesting that could be the case?
It can't be ruled out, and that's why I talked of the Kerala government's resources in the Gulf. If they are operating their resources, they're extremely rich businessmen, and you don't have to be carrying anything around in those areas. All these people have accounts in Qatar and in Dubai and so on and so forth. There are people fronting for them. It's a regular business. Okay. Now, whether some trade-offs have taken place or not, we can only assume. Otherwise, normally, if government of India was negotiating, why would it negotiate for half its citizens and not the other half? How do you explain it to Punjab that their people are not good enough? So that brings me to the conclusion that probably government of India was not negotiating. This has come from somewhere else.
That's a very good point you make, because remember, the Punjab government, the Akali government, is an ally of the BJP. The Kerala government is in fact not an ally. It's a Congress government, and it's very odd, as you suggest, that if the BJP is negotiating, it would not negotiate for their allies as much as it would for their technical opponents. It's a very good point. I don't think anyone can answer it, but it's a very interesting question you raise. To come back, Praveen Swamy, before I go to Dr. Sani, to the fate of the 39 construction workers. You reported in your paper, The Hindu, relying upon senior Kurdish sources, that they had been press-ganged into forced labor. They were building earthworks and defensive fortifications in Mosul. Is that still, from your sources, their present condition? Are they still doing forced labor? Do we have any further information, any further light that we can shed on their condition?
In fact, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, I am told by relatives of the Indians, the relatives of the Indians held in Mosul, sent them assurances last night that the Iraqi Red Crescent had said their relatives were safe, though in captivity. And the family seemed much relieved when I spoke to them earlier today. Having said that, Harjeet Singh Bassi, the single survivor, the single person we know who crossed the lines early on, also had a disturbing tale, not quite corroborated, of these people, some Indian workers, possibly this group or some other group, being in considerable danger. So still a fluid and messy situation. And sadly, very little credible information. I think the one heartening takeaway so far is that there is no evidence that any foreigners in ISIS-held territories so far have been harmed. And I think we should continue to be cautiously optimistic. After all, these are not people who are of any relevance for either side in the hostilities.
Let me take up with you, Dr. Sani, the point that was made by Casey Singh, that it's little difficult to understand that the nurses have had their release, we hope, secured and will be, in fact, in Indian hands before nightfall today. But we have no real credible idea of those 39 construction workers. We're relying on what Kurdish sources have told Praveen Swamy. The ministry has neither confirmed nor denied Praveen Swamy's report that those construction workers are being press-ganged into forced labor. Does that suggest to you that when it comes to the construction workers, we are somewhat helpless as a country? The government in particular doesn't quite know what it can do to help them? Is that a correct conclusion, or is that an erroneous one?
No, my assessment is that the government was helpless in both cases. Of course, what Casey Singh says is a possibility, but everything is a possibility. What I would like to suggest is, I would not like to pretend to know more than I do. And I know, I have no evidence whatsoever to suggest that either government was in charge of any kind of a negotiation, had established any kind of direct contact with the captors. whether the Kerala government or the government of India. Now, we may, of course, be shown evidence subsequently that some kind of a covert operation or some kind of a covert probe had been launched much earlier, of which we are unaware. Everything is possible. I have no evidence to support that, and I would like to suggest that the government of India was quite helpless in both cases. It has had a windfall in this case. It may have a subsequent windfall in the next case.
Let me, in the end, KC Singh, pick up on that last thought from Dr. Sahni. It had a windfall in the case of the nurses. It hasn't had a windfall in the case of the construction workers. Would you, in conclusion, sum it up by saying that we were lucky as far as the nurses were concerned? The same luck hasn't fallen on our shoulders as far as the construction workers are concerned. Is that a fair, balanced conclusion, or is it a slightly churlish one, given that everyone's hugely relieved that the nurses could be back home tomorrow?
I think the luck with the nurses was that the Crete was overrun. Evidence yesterday, New York Times reports, was that 90% of the people have fled from there. So in any case, the nurses were going to be moved from there. So once basically ISIS abandoned, or most of them ran away from Tikrit, it was probably easier to move the nurses. So whichever group moved them may not have been able to move them if there's active fighting going. So that was the luck element. But having come to Mosul, that's where it becomes then where you can't answer the question, because now both groups are in Mosul. If the nurses had been taken directly from Tikrit to Erbil, one could understand different forces were at play. But if both sets of Indians were in Mosul, then why is one allowed to go and one not allowed to go? We don't know. That begs the question.
Very quickly, Praveen Swamy, because time, as ever, is our enemy. How do you answer that question, that if both groups of Indians were in Mosul, how is it that one of them was able, we hope, to cross over from Mosul into Kurdistan, and the other, the construction workers, haven't been able to?
Well, we'll wait till the nurses actually cross over, and hopefully we'll have a better sense of it once people are able to talk to them. They'll be able to give a better sense of what actually happened. But I'd also point out that, you know, it's possible captors felt the captors were different in both cases, and that the group holding the nurses felt a little more sympathetic to a group of single women. And then they would do a bunch of able-bodied young men who would be of some use in a siege. Like Dr. Sahni and Ambassador Singh have said, you know, anything is possible. We just don't know enough. All I'd like to say is, while we celebrate, we should remember that there are Indians still in harm's way and the job isn't done yet.
And a very quick last question and a very quick answer, if I might ask for that. How worried are you about the 39 construction workers who remain in captivity, probably doing forced labor? How worried are you about them?
I'm extremely worried. I mean, remember, every Iraqi who can is trying to get out of that region. People are terrified. There is a possibility of future strikes, particularly airstrikes by the Iraqi armed forces. Fuel, food and water are short. And, you know, any sane person would want to get out. And for people without knowledge of the language, people without any source of support, I'd be extremely concerned. There's no evidence yet that anyone means them harm, but certainly they're in a very dangerous, unpleasant part of the world with absolutely nothing going for them right now.
And that's a very important warning and a reminder for us as we celebrate what is hopefully the successful return home of the nurses, that there are still 39 Indian construction workers held in captivity and probably, as Praveen Swamy says, forced into manual labor against their wishes. We must remember that and we must pray for them. My thanks to all three of my guests for joining me. And there we end this particular episode. Have a great weekend. And if you have been, thanks for watching. Goodbye. Good night.